Scummy she-devils and demons, this is Nurse Hatchet. You are listening to the Wolf Pack.
You're listening to Full Spectrum Horror with Will Norris, Christopher Highland, and the King of Splatter, William Pattison.
Alright. Gonna learn today.
You know, if you stab a man in the dead of winter, steam will rise up from the wounds. Indians believed it was Jason Voorhees escaping from his body. Hello, everybody. This is, let's see, who am I again? Oh, yes. I am your host, Mo Howard. And with me, as always, is Curly Howard, say your hello to everybody, Curly.
Yeah, right, Mr. Highland. Going scared, everybody. This is William Pattison, King of Splatterpunk, and that person who was talking is, of course, the horror sex symbol, Mr. Christopher Highland.
Yes. Yes, I sleep in a bed full of nude bodies.
What?
Every night.
What?
Alive or dead, Mr. Highland?
I don't know.
Alrighty, so yeah, this is, and of course, yeah, you are listening to Full Spectrum Radio here.
Yes, and we have a new format this time. We're debuting this season on of all places, YouTube.
Yeah, indeed.
Where pretty much all the internet stars are at, and have been for quite some time, and we're late to the party, but hey, we're here.
Yeah, finally, isn't that cool?
Yeah.
Yeah, the thing is, Wolfpack fans, Blog Talk Radio discontinued their free host system, and they were expecting us to pay a large fee to stay on there, and it's like, hell no. So we found ourselves a new service that we're using to record our shows, and we're back, and we're better than ever.
Yeah, being canceled one second and then renewed the next.
Pretty much. But that's the thing with wolves. We survive.
Mm-hmm.
Alrighty, so, Mr. Highland, you know, it is that time. You know,
what
the
time?
Thing is, people, that Mr. Highland spends the entire month going over the internet, looking for that fringe, that creepy, that amazing news that we call horror news.
The entire month? Well, I don't know about that, but...
You are a huge nerd.
Yes, I have been diligent in that aspect. And there's not much, but I will... I'll lay it on ya. Okay, not much, but here we go.
Smoke weed every day.
Okay, first up is the book, and this is an audiobook of the book, Crime of the Century, about Richard Speck. This is coming out March 31st. Last year they released this book, and I got it, and I didn't realize they were going to put an audiobook of it. So, it's just ironic. So, look for that in March. Okay. And next, and I'm sure a lot of people are enthused about this.
What?
Tom Holland is working on a novel of Fright Night 3. Now, there's no date on when this is coming out, but or how far along he's in the book, but...
What?
Yeah, just look for that.
What?
Okay, and last, and certainly not the least, this is The Complete Tales of Jules de Grandin, which I've never heard of before.
What?
by the author Seabury Quinn. This is about how Dr. Jules de Grandin is a supernatural French detective.
What?
Never heard of this character until just recently. And this audiobook will be coming out on April 4th.
Cool.
All right. So I have. How about you?
All righty. Well, I have got some interesting stuff from our buddies over at Sideshow Collectibles.
What?
Mm-hmm.
And they just released their newest figure, which is in their 6th scale thing, which is their very expensive ones, but you know, these are high quality figures. They are actually doing a Michael Myers figure from The Curse of Michael Myers.
What?
Even though I don't really like the Michael Myers in that film because you know, he wasn't using the Captain Kirk mask.
What?
This figure actually, you know, it's a good representation of that Michael Myers. So, you know, people who actually like that film,
cocaine is a hell of a drug,
will probably love the figure. And that figure is very expensive. It's like $244.
Smoke weed every day.
Ouch.
But, as I said, also, Sideshow has released a bunch of 6th scale figures from Rogue One.
What?
And they've got the main character, the girl from there, Jin Eros.
What?
And this is an incredible looking figure. I mean, you know, you would think that it was a picture of the actress. It's so detailed. The eyes look pretty much almost alive. It's just amazing work on this. But I've seen a lot of Sideshow's figures, and they're really getting good at
this. You are a huge nerd.
Also, they have the monk figure, the blind monk figure from Rogue One.
What?
And he is just outstanding as well. I mean, just beautiful work on this. And, you know, you got different versions. You got, like, deluxe version, and you have the a regular version. A deluxe version figure will cost you about $244.99. The regular 6th scale figure will cost you $219.99. So $220.
What?
For the regular ones. And honestly, I don't see that much of a difference between the two figures, honestly. They're just outstanding. I mean, I was completely blown away by these.
You are a huge nerd.
So what do you think, Mr. Highland? Are you going to shell out a couple hundred bucks?
Cocaine is a hell of a drug.
No.
No, you're not. Oh, okay. You don't collect figures.
No.
Okay. But you are going to see Rogue One. From what I gather, you haven't seen it yet.
When I can.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I'm going back to see it for the fourth time on Monday.
What?
I'm taking dear sis to see it.
What?
So, it'd be interesting. You know, she's a Star Wars fan, and she's wanted to see it, but, you know, things have been really tight, you know, for the holidays, so I figured I'd treat her. Alrighty, Mr. Highland, are we ready for our main event here?
Yes. Yes, ladies and gentlemen, this is a guest that I've wanted to have on our show for a long time. It has been a long time coming. And I must say it is quite an honor. Now, I won't bore you with any more details, but anyone who knows this person, I'm sure they don't need any introduction, but I'm sure there's a lot more than they don't know. But without further ado, I'd like to introduce and welcome to our show Mr. Adam Marcus.
Hey, guys.
Gordon Scared there.
Hello.
Hi.
All right. Terrific to be with you guys.
Yeah. It's gonna be cool. You know, we do a very casual interview here. So, you know, it's just like talking with friends.
Awesome. Well, Christopher and I have been friends on Facebook for years now, so we've gone back and forth, you know, discussing stuff and talking about things, and Christopher's actually amazing at keeping me up to date on stuff. Like, he sends me links for cool stuff all the time, and so this is something that we've talked about for a while, me coming on and doing your show, and I was psyched to do it. We've got so much going on right now that it was a good time for me to kind of come out of my writing, directing, editing hole and see the light of day again. So I'm glad to be here.
Good. Thanks.
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, first off, I'd like to start off by asking you how you first started out. I mean, were you went to school? What made you want to become a director? What were your influences regarding Jason Goes to Hell? Not just influences. What inspired you regarding Jason Goes to Hell and specifically the body swap aspect?
Mr. Highland, let him answer before you hit him.
I'm just throwing it out there.
Awesome. So. We could start sort of, my origin story, I guess, there are going to be some similarities, I think, to a lot of filmmakers that are around my age, but, you know, when I was really young, when I was nine, the first Star Wars came out, and it was interesting, you guys were talking about Rogue One, I overheard it at the beginning of the show, and for me, you know, when the... when the Imperial Destroyer came overhead, you know, 30 seconds into the film, I gasped. My father had seen the movie in New York the night before on opening night, on Friday night, and he had driven to Westport, Connecticut, where my mother lived, where I was living, and he took me to see the first show, me and my brother, and I'm telling you, that first moment of that Star Destroyer coming over, I gasped, and then I said very quietly, my father remembers overhearing this, I just said, I want to do that. And that was it. Like, from that moment forward, I don't think I spent 1 second of my life not involved in that goal. Everything was about making movies. Everything was about telling stories. And so my best friend when I was growing up was this kid, Noel Cunningham. And Noel's dad made movies. And for the most part, he made really, really inappropriate movies for kids my age. Mm-hmm. But I did not care about that. And they were always needing help on stuff. And I was the first one to jump in constantly. So whenever they needed extras, whenever they needed PAs, whenever they needed anybody to just help, if they needed stuff at the office, I was there working. And Noel's mom, Susan Cunningham, was a brilliant editor. And so I worked with them for a while. I worked with Sean Cunningham. And Sean, cinematically, Sean was, you know, my first real mentor. I was very lucky in that I grew up in, as I said before, in Westport, Connecticut, you know, which is a famous, famous place. It's where Lucy and Desi moved to the country to in I Love Lucy. When they moved to the country, they moved to Westport. It's where Darren and Samantha were from in Bewitched. They lived in Westport, Connecticut. It's where Ira Levin wrote The Stepford Wives about.
Oh,
and in fact, okay. They shot a bunch of the movie in Westport, Connecticut. And, you know, when I was growing up, you know, Paul Newman lived down the street. Martha Stewart was around the corner. Neil Simon lived there. The Weinstein brothers lived there. I mean, it was this extraordinary place. It was, you know, kind of Hollywood, but in this beautiful suburb only about 40 miles outside of New York. It was incredible. And so I went to public schools my whole life, and I'm a huge supporter of public schools. And I got an education that in theater that most people don't get when they go to conservatory schools for college. I was involved with a gentleman named Al Pia. And Al was my mentor from the time I think I was two when I first met Al. My parents were taking acting classes from him, no joke. And he would babysit me when they went to another class. So this man became very important in my life, and he was a Broadway director. He's a brilliant, brilliant man. And he had done films in England in the 50s and 60s with Sir Alec Guinness. He was a really extraordinary person. And so between him and Sean Cunningham, they really started to shape the artist that I wanted to be. By the time I was 11, I was reading, An Actor Prepares. I didn't understand much of it, and that's why people like Al were essential in me breaking things down and understanding stuff at a very early age. And by the time I was 15, I had started my first theater company. By 21, I was running two theater companies, and what was great was that we actually made money. I lived in an area of the country where people really went and supported the theater. And Sean Cunningham, was incredibly essential to supporting my theater company, especially in its early days. And the money that I made in theater allowed me to make movies when I went to NYU film school, which I got early acceptance to when I was a junior in high school.
Wow.
They came to see my work, and it was quite extraordinary, actually. So, so I never even had to deal with, like, you know, filling out applications for stuff. It was like I was just doing this. So I went to NYU, and I had money to actually make some stuff. And the thing about NYU that's incredible, even to this day, I made 18 films when I was at NYU. Hmm. I mean, that's an extraordinary amount. And by the way, this is back when we were shooting film. I only shot 5 videos. But the rest of it, everything was on film, 16mm, 8mm. Super 16 for my last film. I mean, we really did like a lot of we shot just tons of footage and editing on Steenbecks and really learning film in a way that now is in some ways a bygone era, but it really made me understand editing in a really substantial way, because you had to actually touch everything, you had to actually manhandle your footage. And I did a lot of animation, I was so in love with every aspect of this. And while I was at NYU, I had so many jobs. It was insane. I was a bike messenger in New York City. I was a waiter at two restaurants. I worked nonstop because, you know, to make movies and to go to NYU, it's a tremendous amount of cost. And so I started working for a company called R. Greenberg and Associates, which is a pretty remarkable place. If you guys remember, the opening titles of Superman was sort of the first big thing that made this company splash. Like, they were the guys who did those titles. And then they did Flash Gordon, and they did all the visual effects in the old Flash Gordon, the 1980 version. And but they also did the Predator Vision. And by the time I got there, they were doing Silence of the Lambs. So I got to work on that. I got to work on Goodfellas. I got to work on just amazing films and work with incredible directors. I worked with Brian De Palma when I was there. Remarkable cinematographers, and just got to learn as much as I possibly could. And then my final film at NYU was a movie called So You Like This Girl, which stars, it's kind of a crazy thing, the way this movie turned out, but do you guys know who Tom Lennon is?
Oh, yeah.
I'm not sure.
Well, he's Felix on the new version of The Odd Couple that was just on the last couple of years. He was the star of Reno 911. He was the creator of The State. But he also wrote Night at the Museum, The Pacifier, a bunch of, like, ridiculous, crazy comedies. And the guy is brilliant. So he was the lead of my student film, along with Joe Latruglio. And if you guys ever watch Brooklyn Nine-Nine, he plays Andy Samberg's partner. And he's brilliant, brilliant comic actor. So I had, like, this incredible cast for this film. And when we showed the movie at the awards for NYU that year, this is in 1990, we swept. We won Best Picture. We won a special award for cinematography. We won an award that was so extraordinary. It's the first time they'd ever given it, because there was an incredible acting teacher there named Marquetta Kimbrell. And she lobbied for the film to get the first ensemble performance award. Mm. And every single member of my cast was awarded for their acting. And it was this kind of sweet romantic comedy, but the idea was, it was sort of John Hughes meets David Mamet. So very sweet, but very vulgar. A lot of F-bombs being dropped, a lot of language. And so I got noticed by a couple places. Twin Peaks wanted to hire me as a writer right out of school. And Sean Cunningham had seen the film. And his response was, look, come to L.A., be my bitch for a year, quote unquote, and I will, I'll give you your shot. I was like, okay. So I was 20 years old and a numbskull, and I picked the job that got me behind the camera as quickly as possible. So I rushed out to LA. I had no money, zero. Actually, I had $300. But I also had no driver's license, because I'd been living in New York City. I didn't need a car. I didn't want insurance payments, so I didn't have a driver's license. So I get to L.A. I buy a 63 yellow VW Bug, which, by the way, is the exact same car that Kevin Bacon has in Footloose, which is the only reason I bought it. I thought, well, at least I can live in some cinema history, because I had to live in the car, living in a VW Bug. That I couldn't drive, that I had no right to drive. So that was awesome. And I started working for Sean Cunningham, and I had a script by a brilliant young writer by the name of Dean Laurie. And Dean had written this movie called Johnny Zombie that I adored. And he and I had been workshopping this thing for a couple of years at that point. And really had, you know, crafted this movie that was so the first movie I was going to direct. This is going to be my feature. So the film ostensibly is about a kid who's completely average, not a nerd, not a cool guy, just one of the kids in the middle. And he wants to be extraordinary for one night. And he decides senior prom is going to be that event. So he asks the most popular girl in school, who he's been friends with his whole life. He actually says constantly that she's the first girl he ever saw naked, because the two of them would bathe together when they were two. Because he had to stay with her family for a few weeks. And so this guy, on the night that he gets up the courage to ask this girl to go to the prom, he is shot and killed in a convenience store robbery while trying to protect her. And as he lays dying in her arms, he asks her, "Want to go to the prom?" And of course, there's no chance of her actually having to go with him, and he's going to die. And so she says, "Yeah, sure." Well, his need to go to this prom ends up resurrecting this kid from the dead. And he's got 5 days till the prom, but he's going to deteriorate in 3 days if he doesn't start eating the flesh of the living, which he finds absolutely repugnant. And so this guy comes back to have this prom, to go to the prom with this girl, but he's got to eat people. So, by the way, it was really gory, really like out of its mind. It was a hard R movie, but also it was a musical. So it's this insane movie. And so I started sneaking into charity events. I had a lot of friends who were out in L.A. doing catering stuff, and they would sneak me into events, and I would come in a tuxedo and act as though I was supposed to be there. And it was so that I could schmooze people and try to pitch my movie. And I got a couple of people really interested in making the film. I just couldn't believe it. I was like, I was 21 and just completely full of shit. And people were buying it, which was amazing. And so I told my buddy Noel about this, knowing that he would absolutely go and talk to his father about it. So he did. The next day I'm at work, and I'm making copies of the script so I can send it out. And his father sees the script. Sean sees the script on my desk. And he says, "What's this?" And I said, "It's a little movie I want to make." He grabs it off my desk, walks into his office, slams the door shut. Anyway, okay. He comes out an hour and a half later, calls me into his office. He says, "Look, I hate this script. but I love the title. So I'm going to give you $1.5 million and you'll go shoot it in Connecticut." And I was like, "You're going to what now? What's going to happen now?" So, yeah, but he said at that point,
a holy shit moment.
Right. But he said, the only thing is I want to hire a different writer to fix the script. And again, remember, I'm 21, and I say, "Well, then no deal." He was like, "Excuse me?" I said, "No deal. I said, I'm not throwing my friend under the bus because I'm getting some good fortune. That's not going to happen." So I said, "Look," I said, "Sean, here's the thing. Fly Dean out here. Fly him out. Put us up in a hotel for 6 weeks. We'll do whatever you want to the script. We'll work night and day, get the script into shape that you're happy with. And if you don't like it at that point, then you can hire somebody else to rewrite." What's incredible is that he went for this. Now, here's the thing. I desperately wanted to get out of the car. I wanted to live in a hotel. So, as cool as I was being to my buddy, I also was helping myself get out of that damn VW bug.
Yeah.
So, he did it. Flew Dean out here. And the two of us worked on the script for the next 6 weeks. And we were so sure we were going to get fired and sent back to New York. We were so sure this was going to go bad that we started, because Dean and I were pretty much living together in New York at that point. He had a place in Hoboken, but he was losing that place. And I had an apartment in Manhattan that I was still holding on to. And so we started stealing everything that wasn't bolted down at the Holiday Inn.
Oh, my God.
And shipping it at Cunningham Productions shipping it back to New York. So that when we got found out that we didn't know what the fuck we were doing, we would actually still have, like, nice bedding and some plates. Because we were dead broke. We had nothing. So so the two of us, we work on this script, and Dean is just a brilliant, brilliant guy. And Sean reads the rewrite, and he loves it. Absolutely loves it. So because of my theater background, and it was one of the things that Sean really liked doing, because Sean also came from the theater. In fact, he was the stage manager of the original Wait Until Dark, the original road company, Wait Until Dark. Yeah, yeah. So Sean and I, what we did was we started casting with a couple of brilliant casting directors, a guy named Barry Moss, who's no longer with us, sadly, who was out of New York, brilliant guy, and a cast director from L.A. named David Giella, also equally remarkable. And so we started casting these readings because the idea was executives hate to read. They just don't like reading. So why don't we take that away from them, and we'll read it to them. We'll do the reading. You don't even have to read. Just sit down. We'll do it for you. So the first readings of Johnny Zombie, Adam Sandler played Johnny. Because Adam Sandler had been our next-door neighbor, had been Dean and my next-door neighbor at college for years.
Wow, what was that like?
Awesome. Awesome. Huh. He was actually, I got to tell you something, Adam Sandler is one of those guys where success has made him a way cooler dude. He wasn't so great in college. mean. But he's become, like, the nicest guy you could ever want to meet. Totally love the dude. So, anyway, we had the... I mean, dude, we had... Len Carreyrou did a reading for us. George Hearn did a reading for us. Charlotte Ray from The Facts of Life, who is one of Stephen Sondheim's, you know, top actors. I mean, we had unbelievable talent doing these readings. So we got into a little bit of a bidding war on the movie. And Sean Cunningham, being who he is, went for the money and sold to Disney. So Disney was going to do this movie. Dean, at that point, was put under contract at Cunningham Pictures, and he's under a 3-year deal with Sean as a staff writer for the company. And we're going to make the movie with Disney, right? That's how we're going to do it. And this is Disney in the early 90s, so it was kind of the unhappiest place on earth at that point.
Yeah,
and,
I can imagine.
Oh yeah, we go in for the first meeting on the movie, and they're all talking about how much they love the film, and it's on the fast track, and they want to green light this immediately and get going and blah blah blah. And while all of that is happening, they say they only want one change to the script. And Dean's like, well, what's the change? And they said, well, can you get rid of the zombies?
What?
And there was a whole culture of zombies because part of the fun, here's the thing, here's the reason we wanted to make the movie and why I really wanted to make the movie. In the 80s, when I was a kid, a lot of my friends that I worked with, a lot of artists that I was friendly with, died from AIDS because in the 80s, of course, no one would talk about AIDS. Reagan didn't even say the word AIDS until 84. And people were dying left and right in New York, so especially in the art community. And so Dean had the same experience. So what we did with this movie, when Johnny comes out of the grave, there's a whole society of zombies living in the confines of the cemetery. Now, as long as they don't cross the border of the cemetery, they can be there forever. They can just be hanging out. So there's all these zombies kind of having a zombie jamboree in the confines of the cemetery. Well, when Johnny is the only one brave enough to walk past the boundaries to go back to his life, all of these other zombies come out of the cemetery because they want to go home to their families. And we're not talking about bloodthirsty Night of Living Dead zombies. We're talking about people that are just like us, they just happen to be dead.
Yeah.
Well, all of these people start sitting down at their families' tables, and the whole point of the movie was that these people, like so many people who were inflicted with AIDS in the 80s, their families didn't know what to do, And there was a sense that a dead person was sitting at the family table, and no one wanted to touch them, and no one wanted to hold them, and no one wanted to give them the love they so desperately needed, not to get better. There was no cure, but at that time, but just this sense of people loving them, and people pushed away family members who were dying. So while the movie was kind of a horror comedy musical, we were trying to say something. We were doing what George Romero does in the best movies that he's made, which is we were commenting on society's ills, but doing it in a way that nobody knows that's really what we're doing. So they wanted to get rid of the zombies. We were like, ugh. And we're like, but it's called Johnny Zombie. And they said, swear to God, yeah. And about that, could he seem like less dead and more like tired?
Oh my God.
Yeah, that does sound like Disney. It sounds like Disney because, you know, I mean, look at what they tried to do with Tim Burton and Frankenweenie. Oh my flipping God.
Well, but here's the thing. There is the Disney of the 90s, which is a very different Disney than the Disney that is now doing Marvel movies and Star Wars. And Disney has become, what's great about Disney now, and you'll notice more and more filmmakers are flocking to Disney because, look, the Star Wars movies, they're not futzing, man. You know, Kathleen Kennedy is, she's killing it on those movies. The directors are amazing. They're picking great storytellers. They're doing, J.J. Abrams is really allowed to tell the story he wants to unfold. And so you're dealing with a company now that I think has started to respect artists in a tremendous way, and I think they're really reaping the rewards from that. I mean, look at the Marvel franchise. I mean, it's unbelievable. And they make some risky picks on stuff like this. So the Disney of yore was all about family films. It was all about that brand, which I totally understand. But then I was like, but why did you buy this movie? This is clearly a rated R comedy. And you guys are going to take the guts out of it. Literally, you're going to take the guts out of it. So here's the thing. I immediately went back to Sean and I said, okay, this is not for me. This is not the movie I want to direct. They are turning this into something that I don't recognize. I'm not interested. And at that point, Sean gave me probably my greatest compliment, even though I didn't know it at the time. I wanted to kind of smack him in the mouth. But he said, Adam, your greatest talent is you are the world's biggest nudge. And I was like, well, great. You got a movie? I need a movie now. Can I have a movie, please? So I was like, everybody's making a lot of money. I want a movie. And so Sean says, well, look, New Line is buying the rights to the Friday the 13th franchise. And if you can figure out a way to get that damn hockey mask out of the freaking movie, I'll let you write and direct it. Word for word, that's what he said.
Really?
And I said, oh, yeah. And I said, okay. Got my marching orders. 3 days later, I brought him a treatment for what would end up becoming Jason Goes to Hell. And my treatment and the first script was far darker than what we made. Like, so much darker, guys. I mean, bleak doesn't even come close.
Oh.
The first iteration of that movie was the sickest thing I've ever written. It was beyond violent. I mean, violent doesn't even come close. But it was also about myth-making. And for me, I had seen every single one of them in the theater, usually with the Cunninghams or some member of the family. I had been super close to this franchise, so much so, Steve Miner, who, you know, you guys know, directed part two and part three of the franchise.
Oh, yeah.
Steve was Sean's assistant way back in the day on starting from Last House on the Left. And the thing about Steve's nickname was The Kid, because he was literally a kid when he showed up to work for Sean. Well, when I started working for Sean, they passed the mantle of The Kid onto me. So I was, in many ways, destined to start my career with a Friday the 13th movie. There was kind of no way around it. I was cursed by Jason Voorhees. But for me, I love these movies. I mean, they were canon. I just adored them, especially Part 6. I was a huge fan of Part 6. But I always said, and I would say this to Sean pretty regularly, because here's the thing. Sean was not a big fan of the movies. He loved his film. He was very proud of the movie he made. He didn't make it to become a thing that had, you know, over a dozen sequels. He made it as a scary potboiler. It was a thriller. It was a mystery. And it's a great mystery because you never see that moment coming when you realize Mrs. Voorhees is the killer. You just don't see it coming. And the thing about it was by having Jason jump out of the lake at the end, it gave Paramount this great idea of that's what the movies will be about. It'll be about the boy from the lake. So suddenly, here's the thing. You've got a kid who drowns in the 50s. At the end of the first movie, he jumps out of the lake. He's still a kid. He's a hydrocephalic-headed kid. Ari Lehman jumping out of the water. Well, then, literally 2 months later, he stabs Alice in the head in her apartment. And he's a full-grown man. 2 months later. A couple of weeks after that, he's back at camp, and he's the elephant man with the sack on his head. By the third movie, he's a pro wrestler with a hockey mask. And again, the kid in me loves this story. I'm totally in for the ride. But as I got older and started going through my teens, I was like, this doesn't make any sense. So I love when people say, like, well, Part 6 is when it became Zombie Jason. No! Part 1, he's Zombie Jason. He's still a child. He's still a kid in that lake. So how did all of that happen? And for me, Jason Goes to Hell, or what became Jason, originally the title of the movie was Heart of Darkness. And it was a nod, not just to Joseph Conrad, but to Orson Welles, who, to answer your earlier question, was one of my biggest influences when I was a kid. And Orson Welles' first movie that he wanted to make was not Citizen Kane. It was The Heart of Darkness. He wanted to do what Coppola ended up doing many, many years later. But the project fell apart. And in fact, he was going to play Kurtz, which is extraordinary when you think of a 23-year-old Orson Welles was going to do that. So I wanted to tip my hat to Welles, but also the movie was about Jason's black heart, this evil heart. So it was The Heart of Darkness. So that was the original title of the movie, Friday 13th, Heart of Darkness. No part number. There was never a part number. We weren't allowed to put a part number because we were taking it from Paramount. And in fact, there was some stipulation about calling it Friday the 13th. So I don't even think that was allowed at New Line. It had to be some variation on the title, which is why we had the final Friday. So we go to make the movie. Or sorry, I go to write this thing, and I've written this, you know, incredibly dark movie that starts to give answers for why Jason is what Jason is. And one of the things in the film, and you guys know, I put in, you know, I think 28 references to other movies in the movie because I was that guy. I was that fan of all of that stuff. And if you remember, no one was doing that before I did it. There was no Scream. No one was being self-referential. Nobody was putting other people's props in the movies and paying note to it. I did that. And so one of the props that I wanted desperately was the Book of the Dead from the Evil Dead movies. Which, when I was a kid, and the first Evil Dead came out, that movie, we got it on VHS, and this is back when that's all you could get. You couldn't even get Beta anymore, it was gone. So people were passing around copies on VHS, like it was like The Ring, this movie. That was like the secret movie that only the cool kids saw. And I remember watching it in Dan Lowenstein's basement when I was 12, I think. We all gathered around the television to watch The Evil Dead. And I thought it was just freaking brilliant. And it just blew my mind, and I was like, this is the kind of movie maker I want to be. This is awesome. It's so audacious, and they're building cameras out of nothing, and it was so cool. So I wanted that prop. So I was working with the K&B guys, and I was introduced to them by Sean Cunningham really early on. So much so that Bob Kurtzman is still one of my closest friends, and he just worked on my latest film. You guys know Bob, right?
I think.
He's the director of Wishmaster.
Oh, yeah. I remember him.
Okay.
Yeah.
He's the producer from Dusk Till Dawn, but also he is the K of K&B Effects. It's Kurtzman, Nicotero, and Berger. So I was introduced to those guys, and so I wanted them to do the effects on Jason Goes to Hell. So I approached Bob. I said, look, I said, I want to get the Book of the Dead. And he says, well, we're doing Army of Darkness. Why don't you come out to set? So I come out to set, and they are shooting in the middle of a desert with the castle, the whole bit. It was unbelievable, guys. And I asked Sam for the book. And he's like, I love that idea. Awesome. And he gave it to me. Just like, wrapped up the Book of the Dead in a plastic bag and let me have it for the movie. It was the craziest thing ever. But here was the idea. The Book of the Dead is in the Voorhees house when John LeMay goes into the house and he discovers it there. The whole purpose of that was I wanted to track back the idea that Jason's mom, Mrs. Voorhees, made a deal with the devil that she read from that book and brought her son back to life. So what you're looking at the end of that movie, of the first Friday the 13th, and what ends up being Jason, is one of the evil dead. That was the whole idea. It was like, I want this movie to have a connection in film mythology that makes this character make sense. And it was the way that I could also get rid of the hockey mask, which Sean Cunningham hated. He hated the hockey mask. So I was
what do you think of the Stackhead, Jason in part two?
I think he was more okay with that because that felt more sort of woodsy and like this guy just got anything to get his hands on. And look, I personally, I love the hockey mask. I think the hockey mask looks badass. I think it's great. But here's the thing. When he first gets the hockey mask in part three, it is a weird groaner moment. It's weird. Like, what is this hockey mask doing in a barn? It's just weird. You go like, what? Now, again, it made the character look badass, and it made it iconic, which I totally respect. So for me, I get where Sean was coming from. He also just felt like, I think Sean wasn't, you know, a lot of the guys who make these movies, a lot of the guys who do these films, they don't love the genre the way the fans do. They love the money that happens because of these movies. Mm-hmm. They love the success that comes with it. But the problem is a lot of these guys get walled up in their own success. And it's funny because Wes Craven was Sean's partner when I was a kid. In fact, he was Uncle Wes. And Wes Craven, in fact, I was there for one of the first readings of Nightmare on Elm Street. Way back.
Oh.
Way, way back. I was an infant. But we, the thing about Wes was, look at, you know, Wes Craven started making movies that talked about the ills of the movies he made. I mean, he became this incredibly meta director because he was commenting on the work that he was doing. He was commenting on what his place in the world is. And so there's a lot of these guys that, you know, they look at these creations and it's almost like Frankenstein's monster. Like, they create these things and then the things kind of go berserk. And it's no longer your monster. And it's ripping up the village. And that's kind of the way Sean felt at that point about Jason. I think he's turned around somewhat since that time. I think he's more embraced the character, more embraced the world of it. But at the time, you know, it was a little bit cynical, and I was all in. I wanted to tell a great Voorhees story. And what I didn't want to do was make the same movie I had seen over and over and over again. I wanted to do something different. And Sean really wanted me to do something different. So that's why the movie, you know, has all the mythology. It, you know, it has this evil heart of Jason's. It has, we blow him up in the first 10 minutes of the movie. I mean, we did all this stuff not to be shocking, but to tell a different story and to give more of a backstory for Jason, more of a reason for his being. And look, the first thing I said when we started working on the script was, I said, okay, this guy has been in this area murdering people for the last 10 years. He's killed over 100 people. The FBI gets involved at that point. I'm like, it's not the local dumb sheriff who comes in, hey, well, you kids smoking weed? That's not what happens. You got 100 people dying in one small, you know, 20 square mile area of a place. The feds come in. There's a serial killer. And so that's why the sting at the beginning of the movie, where we play, like, against every expectation that the Friday the 13th audience has, whereas, like, you know, I've got the amazing Julie Michaels, you know, going to a cabin in the middle of the night, taking a shower, changing out light bulbs, going to a little shack. I mean, it's like every dumb thing to do in one of these movies to draw him out. And it works. And the feds get him. And so for me, I was like, I want the audience to lose their minds 10 minutes into this movie. I want people to be like, oh no, what the heck, what's coming? Like, if this is what you do in the first 10 minutes, where are we going? And then I told the story of, like, the people of that town, and real people, not children, not 13-year-olds, not 18-year-olds, not just people who wanted to have sex and do drugs, but the lives that are affected by this serial killer, by this thing, this shark in the water. And so for me, that was a more interesting tale to tell. And I still had my teenagers in there, and I still had a lot of, you know, random killings. And look, the movie up until that point was by far the bloodiest of all the films, and it had the most kills. I think Jason X has like one kill more than us. But, you know, I wanted to tell a story that was about the story and not just about kills. But I wanted to give the best kills that the audience had ever seen. So it was matching those two things. And Bob Kurtzman, as I was talking before, and Howard Berger in particular as well, they really made this stuff come to life, you know. But and it's funny, I was literally just talking about this a couple days ago, about how Greg Nicotero and I were underneath this platform operating these giant mud hands that start pulling John LeMay into hell towards the end of the movie. And how Greg and I couldn't see what we were grabbing. We could just feel John's body, and we just had to kind of pull him. And at one point, Greg grabbed John's behind, and I grabbed his crotch.
Oh, God.
This poor dude, God, is like, hey, guys! So, yeah, man, it was, but again, I was 23, you know, I was directing my first feature, when I was 23 years old. Oh, and my brilliant writer from Johnny Zombie, Dean Laurie, ended up writing the script with me, and he did a incredible job, absolutely incredible. I had done the first couple of drafts, and then Dean came in and really just built such beautiful characters, and just, he's a brilliant writer. So that's kind of how all that went down. And that's, you know, sort of the origins on Jason Goes to Hell, at least.
Okay, guys. I think it's, time right now. We can take a break, and then, I want to talk a little bit with, Adam on something that, involves myself and the Friday the 13th franchise. So anyway, we are taking a break here, and when we get back, Adam Marcus, and I will be talking Friday the 13th again.
All right.
I'm gonna make you mine. When you don't go to Geico.com, car insurance can be confusing. Like Swedish techno confusing.
Bark, bark, meow, meow. Dance with me, purple cow. Bark, bark, meow, meow. Ooh, you lovely cow.
Geico makes it easy. With 24/7 access, all you have to do is go to Geico.com and you could save money on car insurance. It just makes sense. Unlike, you know.
Dance with me, purple cow. I like your moves.
Hello, my she-devils and demons. This is Nurse Hatchet, she-wolf of the Wolf Pack.
Alrighty, we're back. Mr. Island, you there?
Yep, I sure am.
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yeah. Alrighty, so we are back here on Full Spectrum Radio with Mr. Adam Marcus. And alrighty, Adam. Yeah, you're going to be amazed by what I have to tell you.
I'm excited.
Alrighty, after you did Jason Goes to Hell, New Line Cinema made a deal with Berkeley Books to do a series of Friday the 13th novels, which would tell the events after Jason Goes to Hell.
Awesome.
And I was actually the guy that they hired to write the books.
That is awesome.
Under my pen name of Eric Morse.
So cool, dude. So cool. That's great.
Well, what's amusing is here you were talking about how Sean Cunningham hated the hockey mask.
Yep.
And how he wanted you to get rid of it and all that.
Yep.
What's amusing is my four books that I wrote for Berkeley Books.
Mm-hmm.
The entire idea of the series was that Jason's hockey mask comes up from hell. And the thing is that anyone who puts the mask on gets infected with the bloodlust and the strength of Jason. So I did four books with each book with a different killer each time.
Right.
And the connection was Jason's mask.
That is hilarious.
And, you know, I thought I did good on the books. The problem was that Berkeley Books had actually, they changed the books there, before they got into print and they decided that they wanted to do young adult novels. So when I'm in there doing the editing on the books, all of a sudden it's like, oh no, you can't show the gore here. Oh no. Oh, and they hired me. They literally hired me. A friend of mine, I was actually working at Kmart as a morning filler, and a friend of mine that worked there, Charisma Jones, believe it or not, her name was.
Great name.
She had a cousin who worked for Berkeley Books. So I got the in on there through Charisma's relative. And sent in to get the, you know, to get the job.
Right.
And the whole thing was because I knew Friday the 13th. And then when I was editing, all of a sudden, every time I mentioned something about the past movies or anything.
Right.
They cut it out.
Amazing.
Yeah.
Amazing.
Yeah,
well, I'm telling you, here's the thing. There were all kinds of rights issues that were really effed up about that series. I wanted the hero of the movie to be Tommy Jarvis, and they wouldn't let me have him. Paramount would not allow it. So New Line didn't own any, New Line owned nothing of those first movies. They owned the Jason Voorhees character, and that's pretty much, I think, what they ended up owning. Because remember, I mean, it's Jason Goes to Hell, Jason X, Freddy versus Jason. Nowhere in there does it say Friday the 13th.
No.
They didn't even own the title.
But what's interesting there is that, well, you know, the thing is that my series basically, you know, they mishandled it. They didn't get the
right.
Get the books out to the fans. Now, of course, the thing is that, I mean, I think about a year ago, a complete set of my books went on auction.
Wow.
In Scotland and sold, believe it or not, you're going to love this, £8,000.
Wow. Wow.
Oh.
It's amazing. That's more than I got paid for my writing services on that movie.
Yeah. I didn't see a cent of this, of course.
Yeah, no, I know.
I know. Yep. So
writers get screwed pretty often, dude. It's kind of the way it rolls.
Oh yeah, you're gonna love this, Adam. Berkeley Books screwed me out of my money for the book series. Yeah, they gave me an initial amount of $1,500.
Mm-hmm.
And then what they said is, oh, well, look at this. We're supposed to have this amount of sales before you get the rest of your money. So I lost out on about another $10,000.
That's lovely. That's very nice.
Out of all that, plus they promised me book signings, they promised me conventions and that.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, you know, to get me writing and stuff.
Sure.
Oh, and here you're going to love this one. I had to write 4 novels in 1 year.
Jesus.
So I got $1,500 for that.
It's amazing. Just amazing.
But anyways, yeah, so anyways, you know, I gave up for a while. And the thing is, fans of mine found me. They brought me out from, you know, because I basically walked away from everything.
Right.
And the thing is, I wrote a fifth novel called The Mask of Jason Voorhees, which I will, you know, after the show's over, I'll send you a copy of it because...
Oh, I would love it. That would be great. I'd love it.
I'll send you a copy of that, and I'll send you a copy of the first of my Camp Crystal Lake series, Mother's Day.
Sounds great, dude. I would love that.
Yeah, those are on PDF, and I give those out to people.
That's awesome. It's awesome.
The Mask of Jason Voorhees, I wrote for the fans, and I give it out to them for free.
Great. Good for you. Good for you.
And you will love this. Your main character in Jason Goes to Hell?
Yeah.
I said that he was in fact Ryan Dalian from Friday the 13th, the series.
Ah, that's awesome. That's funny. That's great.
Yeah, because remember in Friday the 13th, the series, Ryan was turned into a 12-year-old child?
Mm-hmm.
Well, what I did is I had it that his mother put him into hiding, and he grew up again.
That's great.
So my story in The Mask of Jason Voorhees is that his cousin Mickey goes to Crystal Lake to find him, and they end up, they have to stop Jason from being resurrected.
Right.
And what happens is they find out that there's a connection between Pamela Voorhees and their uncle Louis Vondrady.
Mm-hmm.
So in the story, it's Louis who brings Jason back. So literally, Pamela did make a deal with the devil.
Wow.
Yeah, her adopted brother, Louis.
There you go.
And I think you're going to absolutely love what I've done
That's
with
awesome.
It. I mean, there's so many Easter eggs in that one book. I mean, it's epic. You'll love it.
Awesome.
So anyway, and as you know, Mr. Highland's a Friday the 13th author too. He did a story called Tommy Jarvis.
Yeah, and it's what part 6 was originally supposed to be, with Tommy Jarvis becoming the villain.
Right. Right. Right, because that was sort of built on part 5, the end of part 5.
Yes,
and
the way that I wrote it, I kind of had it in a style kind of, at least with the suspenseful parts, with in the style of David Morrell.
Uh-huh.
So I wanted to convey his style, at least with his early work, to the story that I wrote.
Hmm. Great. It's great.
And I felt that I did a good job.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, I read it. So anyways, Adam, I also recall that you did another film that I really appreciate, that a lot of the fans didn't appreciate, but I really appreciated it.
Mm-hmm.
But from what I gather, you did Texas Chainsaw 3D.
Yes. Yeah. My wife and I, my wife Deborah, who's been my writing partner, she actually, I met Deb when I was doing Post on Jason Goes to Hell, and Deborah's an actor as well, and she, so Sean needed somebody to come in and do a lot of the vocals in ADR, and he didn't want to bring all the actors back in, so he had Deborah come in and he wanted her to do all the screaming and the heavy breathing and all that stuff. And so when you listen to the movie, every scream in that movie is my wife. And in fact, I am the voice of Jason Voorhees in that movie. All the grunting when he gets shot and killed and all that, that's all me. So Deborah and I bonded over Jason Goes to Hell. And we've been together ever since. And she became my writing partner the very next year. She's a brilliant, brilliant writer. And so we wrote, we actually had to go up against 17 other teams of writers to get the job for Texas Chainsaw. We booked that job, and we wrote a movie that originally was a $20 million film, and then they went and made an $8 million film. And...
Oh.
There's a big difference between 20 and 8. Enormous difference.
Definitely.
And so the script that we wrote was actually a much bigger movie, and in some ways a smaller movie, because we didn't mess with the timeline the way that they did, which I know is the fans' biggest problem with that movie, and I agree with them. You know, for it to go from the early 1970s to the, 2010s, and the girl is only 20, 21 years old, well, that doesn't make any sense.
Yeah.
And that was not in the script that we wrote. The script got rewritten, for production, mostly because they had to cut the budget so drastically. And so, you know, we had, guys, we had sequences. I mean, just let's put it this way. The sequence at the end of the film, just when he's, you know, when he's trapped by the villain, the real villain of the movie. And our whole thing about Texas Chainsaw was we wanted to tell a Frankenstein story. We wanted to tell Frankenstein's monster, we wanted to tell it from that point of view, of Leatherface was manufactured, that Leatherface was created by his surroundings. That here's this guy who is, you know, mentally challenged, who is insane, who has been driven insane by his surroundings, and we wanted it to be about, you know, this character that's been hidden for, you know, two decades, and then finally gets out and goes up against the people that slaughtered his family without a trial, without, you know, due process, just murdered his entire family. And so that last sequence in the meatpacking plant, there were 14 men that were up against Leatherface in the last scene of the movie. 14 guys, so that it was a fight. In the movie, it's two. It's two dudes and Leatherface. And I'm like, really, you couldn't afford some extras? You couldn't afford some stunt guys for a few days? So, yeah, the movie that got made, not the movie we wrote. The carnival sequence was an enormous sequence. And Leatherface tore through dozens of people. I mean, it was a massacre. There was a massacre at the police station and then into the town. There were so much more gore. It was way more about the 3D of it. If you guys remember the character that Trey Songz played, it just sucks. So in the movie, he dies in the van because the van turns over.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah, not in our script. In our script, the van flips over, lands on its side. He's against the what is now the side of the van, which is actually the roof of the van, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And his girlfriend, Alexandra Daddario, is standing in front of him, okay? And she's trying to wake him up because he's kind of knocked silly. And suddenly they hear the saw, okay? And they're wondering where it's coming from, and they don't know what side of the van it's on because it's reverberating in the side, the sound is reverberating in the van. And she goes to grab her boyfriend, and suddenly the saw comes through his chest. So Leatherface has torn through the back, the roof of the van, through this guy's chest. And he grabs the saw as it comes through, like grabbing it, like trying to stop it. And his fingers launch off of his hands into her face. Pop, 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 pop.
Whoa.
Okay? In 3D. So this is the kind of stuff that we wrote for the movie. It is not what they shot. And, you know, this is the perils of writing movies for other people. This is what happens. And you guys know, you're both writers. When you're a writer, especially in the film side of our industry, everybody's got their own ideas, and everybody wants authorship. They all want to feel like they're the authors of the movie. And every producer, and directors, and directors I do understand, because directors, you are an author of the movie. You are the one who writes the final movie that gets made. But I have to say, the people that were making the movie, Lionsgate released the movie. Lionsgate didn't make the film. Lionsgate was amazing. Lionsgate was, like, I've never had a better experience with a studio ever in my life than Lionsgate. They are extraordinary. Really good. Like, guys, I'm telling you, like, they are, if you ever want to make a movie, those are the people you want to make a movie for. The problem is they didn't make the movie. They released the film. And the people who made the movie could not have cared less about horror. I just couldn't believe it. I couldn't believe it. I would be in meetings where I'd be looking at them like, you guys just don't like these movies. Like, it was crazy, guys. And the problem is that when you hire writers, you're hiring them for their expertise. You're hiring them because they know how to tell this kind of story. And so it was heartbreaking to to see the movie come out the way it came out, only because we knew what movie it could be. Guys, in the last sequence, when Leatherface goes to the, you know, when he approaches the slaughterhouse and gets caught up with these guys, as he's walking through the pens, he's walking through a stampede. There's a stampede of cattle. And so the stampede is running in one direction, and Leatherface, with the chainsaw running, is walking in the other direction through the cattle. And I was like, guys, that's your poster. Like, the poster of this movie is Leatherface with these cattle rushing on every side of him, and the cattle are afraid of him as he's coming at you, you know?
Yeah, I can see it.
Right.
Oh,
so,
yeah.
You know, look, guys, and again, I got to tell you, the actors in the movie, I think, did a terrific job. I think there was, like, I think that, you know, the makeup was fantastic. Everything that was done in that movie was done as well as it could be done. The problem is, it was a movie that was designed to be made for a certain amount of money, and then they, you know, they chainsawed the budget. And and that's a shame. It's just a shame, because I knew the movie that could be, and the movie that could be was badass, guys. I mean, it was crazy movie.
This is why novelizations exist, to have everything that's cut out.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And by the way, look, here's, you know, the best thing that happened as a result of that movie, because that's the movie that really did it for us. When we went to screen the film, we were like, it was kind of like a knife in our hearts. And the movie's already locked. They had locked picture. It was done. We couldn't give notes. There was nothing to be done. And at that point, I turned to Deb. I said, you know what? I don't want to do this way anymore. Like, this is for the birds. I want to tell stories that I want to tell. Like, I want to see our films get made in a way where there's some integrity to the end product of what we wrote. Like, I want to see those movies. That's why I came into the business to begin with. And so it was at that point that we joined forces with my best friend, this guy Brian Sexton, who's amazing dude, he actually, funny enough, he worked for Sean Cunningham after I had left Cunningham Pictures.
Oh.
He worked for Sean. And he was on Freddy vs. Jason. He was there for that movie. And Brian ended up being an associate producer on a film that we made in the late 2000s called Conspiracy.
Yeah.
That my wife and I wrote and that I directed. And it's the single worst film I've ever been on. It was a disaster. And it was a disaster for two reasons. The first was my star. The second was... a producer that was unscrupulous, to say the least. I had a producer on this movie who was so errant in her duties. She made coming to set every day a nightmare for everybody. Just one of the worst people I've ever had to deal with on a film set. And match her with my lead actor, and you've got really a powder keg. Which is the saddest thing in the world, because the rest of the people involved in the movie were extraordinary, like everyone top to bottom. But that's where Brian and myself and Deborah really bonded, and where I became so close with him. And so I have this amazing guy who has made like 40 movies, produced like 40 films, but he's working for some pretty lousy folks, and we asked him to join forces with us. And so a little over a year ago, we created a company called Skeleton Crew. And we are making all our own material. And it's been extraordinary. I mean, it's been the coolest, most amazing. I've never had a more exciting year than the last year I've had. And, you know, we're doing things in the way that I wanted to do them, which is working with a collective of artists where everybody helps and creates things together. where everybody gets to feel some ownership of a movie and some authorship. We're doing, you know, we have three different divisions. One is a TV division. One is our sort of mid to larger budgeted films. And the third division, which is kind of my favorite spot, is sort of what I've been dubbing my Roger Corman division, which is we make these ultra-low budget films where nobody's going to get rich, nobody's going to make any real money up front, but everybody shares in the picture. And you end up making, giving like, I've got all of these brilliant writer friends who have written great screenplays and who have, you know, and I'm saying for the studios, who've made a lot of money for the studios and done really well, and they can't get a directing job. But that's why they started writing in the first place. And so some, you know, some really remarkable talent that's been coming out with incredible scripts that they can do for very little money. And I, one of the things that I've been doing in LA for the last 20 years is I teach acting and directing. And I've got a troupe of 70 of the best actors you could ever find. They are unfreaking real, and a lot of them you would recognize because they do a lot of TV work. And they're amazing. And the thing is, all of these actors, you know, they get jobs, and they, you know, they get to do, you know, play the victim on a show or play a cop on a thing or do. But that's not what they came to L.A. to be. That's not what they, I mean, they wanted to play leads, and they wanted to do really complicated, interesting work and big movies and, you know, do all this stuff. And so what I designed was this group is now a troupe. They're the Skeleton Crew troupe. And so when a director comes in to do one of these lower-budgeted films, they are given a digital portfolio of the troupe. And anyone they want to read, they bring them in for reading, but this is your cast. Find your cast. And I've got people from 14 all the way to 75 in this troupe. So I've got this amazing group of people. And so we shot a film last year called Secret Santa. We just released some info on it, online about it. The trailer can be seen online. And we are... we're running the festival circuit this year, and then we are we're going to be releasing probably right November, it looks like. And it is I've never been more proud of a movie that I've made in my life.
Wow.
So I wrote and directed. I wrote it with my wife and directed it, and my wife and I and Brian Sexton produced it. Brian really you know headed up the producerial reins on it. And it's an incredible, it's just a great movie. I'm just so freaking proud of this thing. And I've got this unbelievable cast. I've got some awesome people in it. Great guy named Michael Rady. Do you guys watch Unreal? If you watched the show Unreal, Lifetime's big show?
No.
Just won the Peabody Award. It's an amazing show. It's ostensibly about what goes behind the scenes at sort of a Bachelor-type show. But it is the ugliest, it's the ugliest thing on television. It's extraordinary. Anyway, the lead of season two, Michael Rady, is one of my guys, and he's one of the leads of Secret Santa. He's brilliant in it. And then, I don't know if you guys know a guy named Drew Lynch. Do you guys ever watch America's Got Talent?
Occasionally I have him long ago in the past.
Well, last year, the guy who came in second, the stuttering comic, kind of a cherubic-faced guy named Drew Lynch. The guy is selling out all over the country. This kid is unreal how good he is. And he's got this stutter that I've been working with Drew since before he had the stutter, and he had a baseball injury, which has given him a permanent stutter. And he has turned it into comedy gold. It's unbelievable how brilliant this guy is. So he's one of my leads. My wife, Deborah, is playing, she's doing the best work of her life. And she just did a movie with Steve Guttenberg back-to-back with this film. Yeah, she's playing a lead opposite. She plays Steve Guttenberg's wife in this new film that they just made, which is terrific. So we've got all these up-and-coming, wonderful actors. I've got a great girl named A. Leslie Kies that you guys, she was on The Newsroom. She was on Stalker. I mean, she's done like a ton of stuff, and she is, mark my words, this girl is the next Emma Stone. She is un-freaking real how good this girl is. I've got an incredible girl named Michelle Renee Allaire, who is the sexiest, most outrageously beautiful woman. I'm telling you, dudes, whew, my God, just like your head explodes. She's so knockout. It's crazy. Just so many remarkable, talented people that I'm getting to work with and giving a chance to God. Look, I got a guy, this guy Tim Eilers, who I've known since I was in my 20s, my early 20s. And he is a sculptor for, like, large props. He just did Guardians of the Galaxy 2 back-to-back with Fast 8. Okay? So he does, like, these huge studio pictures. But all he's ever wanted to do was write music. That's all he's ever wanted to do. And so I went to him. I said, dude, you want to get off the road and finally write music? And he was like, oh, my God, yes. Please, yes. I said, great, jump in. Do this soundtrack for me. If everything works out, you're my company composer. Guys, the soundtrack on this movie is so epic. It's so beautifully done. And while I'm doing all this, right, the same guy, we started, kind of filing up all of our VFX shots, everything we need to do visual effects for. And I'm going, oh, man, this is going to crush the budget. We had like 70 shots. And Tim goes, dude, that's what I do. I was like, what do you mean that's what you do? He goes, I teach this stuff. I can do all of this. I'm like, you're kidding me. He's like, no. And last night, hand to God, last night we finished the last VFX shot at his studio. Oh. And that's my composer who's doing that, right? My edit, my cinematographer, this guy Jason Honeycutt, who he works for FX Networks, and he's one of their lead promo guys. He cuts all the promos for the shows, and I mean, he does a ton of shooting for them. He's amazing. So here's my cinematographer, right? The guy is, an amazing writer, a great director. Has made these wonderful shorts. Got a new one out called Super Mom. It's all over the country right now. He's just killing it. But this guy's day job is he's an editor. So when I'm editing the movie with my editor, the two of us, I'm one of the editors of the film because that's been my passion my whole life. But Chris Kirkpatrick is editing with me. And Jason came in. We were in this crunch. And Jason's like, dudes, I can help cut some of this stuff. And we're like, awesome. And suddenly you've got three guys working in tandem cutting the movie together. That doesn't happen. Our business precludes that kind of camaraderie, that kind of brotherhood in filmmaking. And so now I've got this troupe of amazing actors and this troupe of amazing filmmakers. And we're about to make Bob Kurtzman's next film that he's directing that Deb and I wrote and we're producing with Brian. And Brian's actually going to be producing a huge movie that I can't say anything about yet because we haven't hit the news yet. But we've got a giant film that we're making for Lionsgate. Yeah. Next month we start pre-production. And it's awesome, guys. And it's, we're hitting new genres. We're hitting things that we're just telling stories that we really want to tell. And we get to say yes and no. Like, no, we're not going to cut that story down. No, we're not going to bow to some kind of nonsense logic that makes somebody feel like they're an author of the movie. We're going to tell the stories we want to tell. And there is something, and because of Brian, we're able to tell it in a way that budget-wise, I've never made a movie that went $1 over budget and never been late on a movie. And that's the way I work. And Brian is exactly the same way. So things, we contain them so that there's never a loss on any of the pictures. Everybody can make money. And look, I understand it's a business and you got to make money. I get it. So we work towards that end, but we tell the stories that we want to tell and we let people feel like artists and, give them the chance to do the dream job they wanted to do. And it's been incredibly rewarding. It's like the coolest It's the coolest experience I've ever had.
Yeah, it sounds like it, very much so.
Well, you're very lucky.
Thank you.
Not everyone can fulfill their potential.
Well, but you know what? I got to tell you something honestly. I would have agreed with that, especially about filmmaking, about 10 years ago. I would have agreed with that statement because filmmaking was this incredibly cost prohibitive mechanism for storytelling. It just was very hard for people to be able to tell stories because you just had to pay for, just the fact that you had to pay for film. I made a movie that was a big hit at Sundance back in 1998, 2000. We were there for the 2000 festival. And it was this tiny little sweet movie. And, guys, I mean, just buying film stock, I was shooting on 35 millimeter. That was more of my budget than anything else because it just costs so much money. Here's the thing. A couple of years ago, the movie that won Sundance was shot on an iPhone.
Yeah.
So there's no... The only borders we put up, the only things that stop us are our own imaginations now. Because here's the thing, you can have a million excuses as to why you're not doing it, but that's all they are is excuses. Because guess what? We all have phones. You can shoot a movie on your phone now. And look, we live in a world where Paranormal Activity is has six sequels. We live in that world. We live in a world where little tiny movies with some ingenuity behind them, with some real ideas behind them, have done incredible business. So I just feel like, whenever I'm teaching at film schools, whenever I'm talking to young filmmakers, whenever I'm around, speaking with people, I'm always talking about you're gonna talk yourself out of all of your best moments in your life. You're gonna find a way to talk yourself out of them instead of going out for the weekend and going bar hopping on a Saturday night. Get some friends together and make a movie. Just make something, anything. Look at the movie Lights Out. That comes from a 2-minute short film. Mama, tiny short film. The Babadook, short movie. All of these stories come from these little scrappy independent filmmakers who had no money, but they went and made a movie. And I just feel like now we have the tools. I have editing software on my phone. That's insane. You used to have to sit in front of a machine that weighed over 1,000 pounds to cut a movie.
Oh,
and now,
I remember that myself when I was in film school.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I used to do Super 8.
Right, sure, me too. I started on Super 8.
Yeah, just doing that. I remember the good old days when I was in film school and having to process Super 8 and all that. These kids now, they have an opportunity because they don't have to deal with film processing. They don't have to go for the cost of actually processing films. All that money that would have went to film processing can go into the film itself for sets, costuming, everything.
Yep.
And
absolutely.
Now you got drones. And you can actually shoot the big shots and everything.
I have got 3 shots in the film that look like I spent $20,000 per shot to get a helicopter, fly it up, do that. It's all drone footage. And it is so gorgeous. It is so jaw-dropping. The last shot of this movie, I'm telling you, whenever I play this thing, people, they go slack-jawed watching this thing. And I sit there going, that's the first and only take. And the only reason it was the first and only take is because once we shot it, I looked at it on my phone. And it's a 4K shot. It's as good a quality as you could possibly get. You can't even show a 4K movie. And it's that good a quality.
Oh, yeah. Yeah,
you know, and it cost me, you know, $1,200 for the drone. So all of those shots, which would have cost me, you know, tens of thousands of dollars, now cost me $1,200, and I own the drone, so I can shoot other things.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I mean, I've seen a lot of things that are just great for filmmakers that are fairly inexpensive. I mean, hell, I saw these glasses that you could do POV shots.
Yep. Yep. And again, the recording mechanisms in all of these things, I mean, they record such an incredible number of megabytes per second that you're dealing with cinematic information that is so beautiful, so beautifully rendered. And that's, guys, I mean, a GoPro costs nothing now. I mean, nothing. And you're shooting at 4K.
Yeah. I mean, seriously, I mean, you look at some of these, you know, like Star Trek fan films.
Right.
And they're doing special effects scenes.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
In their computers, and it looks like, oh, my God, it's paramount
yep.
quality.
That's right.
Special effects.
That's right. So, look, I and again, I'm not even saying that you have to have the wherewithal to know how to do all the Adobe stuff. And, I get it. There's an overwhelming feeling to so many of the programs and the ideas. Look, I mean, you know, simply I cut on Avid. And we shot everything on Red because I do want the best quality I can get. But I got to tell you, it's like if you reduce it down to what's the story you want to tell? What do you want to tell? What story? And then find the people who can help you tell that story, who also want to tell stories. Because there's so many people out there that just want to be a part of this art form. And I think we need to start really going back to the idea that it is an art form. Yes, is it a money-making thing? Absolutely, it is a business. I get it. But the best movies are made not because somebody figured it out on a spreadsheet. The best movies are because you're passionate and on fire about it, and you have to tell that story, and you find people who will sometimes argue with you, who will sometimes cause you all kinds of stress, but it's because they love what you're doing as much as you love it.
Oh,
and
yeah.
And so for me, that's, you know, that's filmmaking, and I think the more we get back to that, the better our movies are going to be, plain and simple.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, we need more of that because it's too, in films that we tend to see, it tends to be more about special effects and...
Sure.
You know, things like that, and just things that are just overblown, and I think movies have just gotten too big.
Mm-hmm. And if you think about, like, let's say even a movie like, let's say, Swingers, right, which discovered, like, this whole world of talented people to, you know, to be in front of the camera, but also behind the camera, and you look at that movie, it's just a series of scenes of the guys talking. That's what it is. It's just really well written, and the actors are amazing. And that's what you need. You need great performers and really good words for them to say. And if you have that, you know, you would watch any of Richard Linklater's stuff, and you just go, man, this is just really honest work with great dialogue, with great stories being told because people are just talking. You don't have to have a ton of effects. And by the way, I'm an effects guy. I love effects. But
yes,
I will tell you, the new one that
I
did, the dialogue is more the effect than anything else.
You just reminded me of something I wanted to ask you about the effects of Jason Goes to Hell, such as
sure.
Melting Man and the Heart and
oh yeah,
things like that. Oh, I mentioned before that the Melting Man grossed me out.
That's awesome. My buddy Bob Kurtzman's going to be really proud that you said that.
who was under all that makeup? Was it the original person who started
no,
Melt, or was
Andy,
it?
Andy Block, who played that character, he was under it for the first two phases of the makeup.
Yeah.
And then I can't remember the actor's name. He was wonderful. We had a an Asian gymnast who, very thin guy, and just was so, like, okay with all the makeup effects, everything we were doing on him. So it would look like his whole body was shrinking, that Andy's body was shrinking underneath him. So for phase three and four of that makeup, it was that gymnast who was who played the character. So we switched out the actor midway through.
I remember telling you in the past that that scene contributed to me not eating as much cheese. And it's only until recently that I started eating cheese on at least a semi-regular basis. I have Leslie Dean to thank for that. She said, she posted a picture, said, "This is me when I'm craving grilled cheese." And I said, "Oh, you like grilled cheese too? Oh, I'll start making them again." So I've been eating it lately.
Awesome.
Yes, horror films can be beneficial to people's diets.
Oh, sure.
Eric Morris knows what I mean.
On the first screening,
go ahead.
On our first test screening of Jason Goes to Hell, speaking of going on a diet, we were about, I don't know, 12 minutes into the movie, 13 minutes into the movie, when Richard Gant, as the coroner, eats the heart.
Mm-hmm.
And in the third row of the theater, as this very first screening of the movie, guy pukes everywhere.
Oh! Yeah, I remember when I first saw that part grossed me out.
And what's incredible is the two executives who... That's amazing. Two executives who were my executives on the movie, Mark Ordesky, who is a genius. He actually was the guy responsible for the Lord of the Rings films happening at New Line. He's brilliant.
Nice.
And Mike DeLuca, who's like the Energizer Bunny of filmmakers. I mean, the guy is incredible. The two of them high-fived when the guy peered. They were so excited. They turned, like, we walked out of theater, they were like, "This is going to make so much money." I'm like, "Well, there you go. That's awesome. Great." But they were thrilled that somebody peered. Yep. Yeah, the best thing that could have happened in my first screening of that movie.
Oh.
Yeah, one thing I do have to say, Adam, is thank you for that film, because you opened the door for my Camp Crystal Lake novels, which, I was able to add a lot of supernatural in it.
Awesome. Awesome.
You know, what gets me is a lot of Friday the 13th fans sit there and go, "Oh, no, Jason isn't supernatural. Excuse me?" I mean, how many bullets has that guy taken?
Ridiculous.
Yeah,
as exactly. Supernatural as Freddy Krueger. Yep, I agree with you.
One of my ideas that I've had, I wanted to mention the jelly hearts. One of my dreams is having a business that has that makes horror themed, not just pastries, but it would make horror themed desserts, and I would like to have jelly hearts.
That is awesome.
I can just imagine people at horror conventions walking around eating jelly hearts, like they're apples.
That's a great idea. I love it.
Oh, yeah.
And there would be things like edible dioramas.
Adam. Yeah, yeah. One thing I do have to mention is, you were talking about filmmakers taking advantage of all the new systems. You will not believe this, but there actually is on YouTube an adaptation of my first Friday the 13th book, and it was done by a fan of mine, and you're not going to believe how much it cost him to make the film.
Tell me.
$2,000.
Awesome. It's awesome.
He did an entire Friday the 13th film It's a 90-minute film. It has special effects and everything.
Yep.
Good dialogue, everything. And $2,000.
That's right.
It blows me away.
Well, guys, look. Okay, I was I'm talking with a executive, amazing producer, a woman named Vanessa Koifman. This was about a year ago, and was on one of the films that I'm adapting, which is RKO's movie, the old film I Walked with a Zombie, is one of our films.
Ooh.
And yeah, and I my wife and I wrote it, and I'm directing it, and so I'm talking to my executive. And she's going to end up producing the picture. And she says to me, look, you know, I mean, we really have to stay, you know, at a reasonable budget. You know, because we got to keep the cost down. I said, okay, well, what are we talking about? She goes, well, it's going to have to be under $5 million. I was like, Vanessa, that's a lot of money. I said, I'm not going to be upset at $5 million. It's a small movie. I mean, it's our take on it is more like The Orphanage. You guys saw that film, right? The Orphanage?
Oh, yeah. I love that. Okay.
So
yeah.
It's like that. It's that kind of, it's that meets Turn of the Screw. So, yeah. So, but it's based on, you know, the original RKO classic. And I said, yeah, that's enough money. I said, quite frankly, I don't even know if I need that much. And she's like, well, you're used to much bigger budgets. I said, well, yeah, but not all the time. She goes, well, for God's sake, she said, Adam, your first movie, you know, Jason Goes to Hell, I mean, that was a big budget movie. I said, no, it wasn't. She's like, oh, come on. She says, Adam, that was what, $18 million? I said, Vanessa, that movie was $2.5 million. She's like, it was not. I said, it absolutely was. So
oh, yeah.
I said we had about $500,000 for rights to everybody who owned the rights on the movie. I said it was $2.5 million, and she's like, "Oh, you're so full of shit." I was like, "I'm not full of shit," and I hear her clicking on her computer, bringing up this studio tracker software that basically says what everything was actually made for. And as she clicks, she suddenly stops and goes, "I said, oh, you just checked me out, didn't you?" She's like, oh, my God. She said, how did you do that? I said, well, Sean Cunningham is a brilliant producer, and I know how to make a movie. She says, you were 23 when you finished that film. Are you kidding me? I said, I'm not kidding you. She said, how are you not running Hollywood at this point? I said, I don't know. I said, you tell me. But that's the thing, guys. It's people's perception of what this stuff costs. Is so berserk. It's so nuts.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
It doesn't need to be. It just doesn't need to be. I mean, honestly, now, you know, I see things because of the technology, because of what we can pull off and do such a beautiful job with, I see things at a far lower budget. And you end up with a great movie.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I'm associated with a bunch of independent filmmakers.
Uh-huh.
And they're making it, you know, just, you know, like, you know, at like, you know, maybe $7,000 or $8,000 or something like that,
mm-hmm.
you know,
just
doing real, you know, and doing guerrilla filmmaking where the shoot is only like 4 days and they just get out there and do it.
Right. And look, again, you know, with this company, we're definitely trying to make things that are, you know, that are a little closer to studio level. But, you know, but look, guys, the days of the, you know, the $60 million movie are kind of over. The days of the $25 million movie are kind of over. People are making movies smaller and smaller and smaller. It's the way to make sure that we can keep making them.
We need to learn that. Because, I mean, look at the last... you know, Star Trek Beyond, what was that, $100
right.
million dollars
right.
that they put
right.
into that film? Shit, they could have made like 100 films for the price of that.
Sure. But again, look, the big franchise tent poles, those movies are designed in a way that they've made the money before they've even spent the money. So I understand when they spend this insane amount of money on a tentpole film. That makes perfect sense. That's just logical. It's that we now have low-budget films and mega-budget films, and there's nothing in between. And that's the incredible part, you know, is keeping the costs down to such a point where you can make the movie and still make a profit. And look, you know, our business has to sustain itself. And in an age when a lot of people are stealing movies on the internet, which, you know, it's just easy to do, we have to combat that some way. And look, we used to be in an industry where people would make so much money per movie that you only had to make a couple movies. And you were set. Now? No. No. And I always tell people when they want to become filmmakers, I'm like, look, do it because you love it. Don't do it because you think you're going to get rich. That can happen. That's awesome. It's great when it does happen, but it doesn't happen a lot. It's most people, you are, you know, you're working class. You're just making a living and doing the thing. The difference is you're doing the thing you love. You're doing the thing you were born to. You know, I can say from the time I left college, I have never had to have a job other than being a filmmaker. That has been my job since college. I teach acting. I teach, you know, I sometimes teach filmmakers. But it's all about my chosen career. And that's, you know, that's part luck, without a doubt. I'm never going to say that it's not. I think that's there. But it's in not having a plan B, in saying, this is it. This is what I'm going to do. And I'm not going to have any excuses for my life. I'm going to do the thing that I was born to do.
So, that is awesome. Okay, guys, guess what? We are within a few minutes of reaching the limit here on our show.
Okay.
That is absolutely amazing about how much we've done in this time. I mean, it just went fast.
Yeah.
One quick thing I did want to say that we didn't get a chance to explore, but I just wanted to have 1 second to say it. Christopher, I read some of your writing over the last couple of weeks. In particular, your sort of, you know, kind of amazing take on the Cinderella legend. And I just want to tell you, man, you're a good writer. I was very excited by what I read. I thought that was super, super cool, man. And I just want to give you props for it, because I had not read your writing before that, you know, before you had sent me that. And it was just really cool to read, and I was like, this is a totally, like, completely different take on familiar material. And I just thought it was fresh and very cool. So I just wanted to give you the shout-out, man. I just thought it was awesome.
Thank you. Do you think I have what it takes to really, you know, not just be a writer, to be a good storyteller for not just with novels, but even with the on-screen?
I got to tell you something. There are things that were written in this that actually felt as though they were from a screenplay. So, I think there's definitely an impulse there that I think you should totally nurture.
Oh, definitely. I mean, I've always had, you know, confidence in Mr. Highland. I mean, he is a good writer.
Yep.
I've worked for 20 years to get to that point in that chapter.
Well, that's, dude, I'm telling you, that's Sandy Meisner, who is my hero from an acting perspective. He was an incredible actor and then became an amazing teacher. He said, from the day you start studying, it takes 20 years to be a great actor. He said, and that works for all professions. From 20 years from the moment you start studying, that's when you're great.
I felt it would take that long when I first started writing.
Nobody does. None of us. We all think we're geniuses when we start out. And then we learn we're not geniuses, and that it takes a lot of hard work and a lot of practice. And, you know, I've written over 80 screenplays. And, you know, and I've made a handful of movies that I've directed. And, you know, this is, it's a long haul, but if you really love it and you stay with it, you get really good at your craft. And so I think it's awesome that you've stayed with it. I think it's amazing. Good for you.
Thank
you. It shows.
Thanks. I put everything I had into it.
Awesome. Awesome.
All righty. Adam.
Yeah.
One little thing before we go to end the show.
Sure.
I want you to do a little plug for the show.
Sure.
So you know, and I'll edit it out. We can use it. It's just simply say, you know, like you know, well, do it your own way, but something basically. Hey, this is Adam Marcus, and I'm hanging with the Wolfpack.
Got it. Awesome. You want me to give you a countdown?
Sure.
Okay. And in 3, 2, 1. Hey, y'all. This is Adam Marcus, and I'm having the best time of my life hanging with the Wolfpack.
Thank you much there, Adam.
You got it, brother.
Oh, wait. Is there anything last minute that you'd like to mention? You know, like any conventions or anything that you'd like?
We're going to be doing a lot of conventions and a lot of festivals in the next 10 months. Nothing that I want to do a shout out to yet, but we'll definitely be doing it, and I will let you guys know where we're at, so maybe you guys can give people a heads up on that. But I'm telling you, man, just keep your eyes open, especially on YouTube and on Facebook. And, you know, you can find me on Twitter and on Instagram at Skeleton Crew Pro. One word, Skeleton Crew Pro. That's my handle on both of those, on Twitter and Instagram. And at Adam Marcus on Facebook. And wait for Secret Santa. Secret Santa's coming, and it is awesome. It's the first movie out from Skeleton Crew, and we've got 4 films going this year and a TV series. So we are cruising with Skeleton Crew. So Skeleton Crew and Secret Santa, that's the stuff to look out for.
All right.
All right.
All right, Mr. Highland, you got any last words here for the show?
No, other than thanks for tuning in, thanks for listening, and check us out next month for whatever we're going to be doing.
Alrighty, cool. Yeah, that's the thing for me there, people out there. So remember, as always, keep America strong, watch horror films, and release the beast. This is the Wolf Pack. Signing off. Oh!
Bye.
Travel the world and the seven seas.